Hello and welcome back to the AgostinhoZinga show with me, your host, AgostinhoZinga, and this is episode number 445. That's 445 of the AgostinhoZinga show. How you doing? How you feeling? Great, amazing, good to know. If it's your first time checking out the show via YouTube, you know what to do. Make sure you smash that like button, hit subscribe, and of course, leave me a comment down below. That would be more than appreciated. And if it's your first time tuning into the show via the podcast, then please make sure you leave me a nice five-star review via whatever review platform you listen to the audio version of the podcast. If it's Apple, if it's Spotify, whatever you can use it, make sure you slap in a little five-star review for your boy. That will help to go the show to spread and get a long way from there, right? Is that where to go? Yeah, you know where to go. And of course, bonus episodes of the show are available via Patreon. Patreon at patreon.com/Agostinho. That's patreon.com/AgostinhoZinga. Jump on there, get involved, support today. One bonus show, sometimes two per week. So get in there, get involved, don't delay. Get involved on Patreon today. So how's the deal? What's up? What's up? Hope you are well wherever you may be. I am currently on the mend, well as can be. As you can probably tell from the sound of my voice, my sinuses have erupted in the last, what, 5 or so days, maybe a week, which is, you know, to be expected considering the change in seasons. But I have a feeling a lot of it, the severity of it now, has some way to do with the fact that I've been indoors all this time, right? We're obviously living on a lockdown. We're living in panoramic times. So I'm sure my immune system, which is usually coming under constant attack from being on the central line, going on a bus, attending a nightclub, right? Just being outside in London day to day. You definitely have your immune system gets tested more so in a rigorous fashion than it would do getting, you know, being holed up at home, locked in place, trying to prevent yourself from catching a deadly virus that may result in you losing a limb. So I'm sure some of the consequences of it has been the fact that my sinuses now have erupted in a way that I've never really had it in a long time. So please excuse the bunged up sound of my voice or whatever it may be, but hey, you're gonna have to bear with whatever I can present at this given moment. And hopefully as time progresses, as the week goes by, you know, I get more oxygen in my lungs and shit, stuff starts to kind of free up a bit and I'm a bit better than before. But hey, we are where we are. Apart from that, what else has been going on? Banged out a few movies over the weekend. I watched Aliens, actually, the sequel, for the first time in full from beginning to end, which was pretty decent, more than decent, actually, especially when you consider how long ago it was filmed, you know. The effects aren't the greatest, but the actual story itself, how it kind of holds your attention throughout, even though you most often do not know what's going to happen due to the references in pop culture and whatever. Maybe even if you haven't watched the movies, a lot of those movies from that era, they're so ingrained in our cultural lexicon that it's pretty easy to kind of piece together where the story is going to go. But yeah, man, what a captivating movie. Really, really captivating. Of course, I would still say the original is probably better. This is coming from somebody who's a non-horror fan. You'd probably, you know, it's probably not as scary as some people are used to in terms of horror, but for me it's probably up there, so it's why I avoid that genre altogether. But I found Alien really enjoyable, so that was a good little watch. Then of course I caught up on, what are we, episode 3 now of Line of Duty, and I have to say, man, I'm disappointed. It's not that great. I'm not too sure if it's something to do with, you know, getting older and then just seeing stuff. No, well, yeah, I guess maybe it's a condition of the fact that I'm watching so many other TV series, especially from Europe, right? We got stuff like Engrenage, Spiral from France, which is maybe one of the best, if not the best, cop drama in this genre, without a shadow of a doubt. Without a shadow of a doubt, it's definitely up there with stuff like, you know, The Shield or The Wire. So maybe when you compare Line of Duty with those sort of dramas, it doesn't really come up to par. But I still maintain the first 3 seasons of Line of Duty were maybe some of the best TV I've ever watched in terms of like dramas, like definitely up there. The writing, the acting, the pace, the plots, the flipping, you know, the twists and turns throughout the entire thing. Epic, 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 epic. But so far this latest season, even though the actors, I'd say, who's the guest actor? I forgot her name, but the guest actor is one of the ladies that was in Boardwalk Empire, right? Nucky's like mistress. I forgot her name, but she's in there at the moment. And it just isn't that great. I don't know what it is about it. It's just not the best thing. Maybe it's because there's not as many, you know, again, non-spoiler alert, because I'm not really going to reveal the plot if you don't want to watch it, but there's not as many deaths as there were in previous seasons. There aren't very much, you know, there's not a lot of really epic, like, revelations or twists in the story. Everything is sort of like, it's sort of like they're kind of dragging it out, especially once they, I think we should have, I should have known Line of Duty was not going to be the same as before, or at the same level as it was prior, when they revealed that the, you know, this kind of enigmatic, mysterious figure called H, who everyone was trying to uncover who it was, who was kind of behind the whole, you know, like bent coppers sort of thing going on in Line of Duty. When they made it known that it wasn't one person and it was like a series of people or a conglomerate or four people represented underneath the banner, whatever it may be, that's when I should have known it was going to go off the rails. Because since then, they've just been longing it out. And it kind of feels like a bit to me like, do you remember Prison Break? The first two seasons of Prison Break were like great, and then once he started to go back and in it, back in prison again, it just got a bit shit. Same feeling I get with Line of Duty. There's no real rhyme or reason why they should have longed it out this far along, but I guess because, you know, it kind of garnered a bit of a cult status in the fandom. It's a great way to get people to kind of tune back into watching the BBC day to day, because, or week to week, I guess, on a week by week basis, because who else is going to check out BBC, you know, other times than that, especially when stuff like Great British Bake Off and all that sort of stuff isn't on. So that might be part of the reason. But whatever it is, it's just, I don't know, man. I've just not been enjoying it. I have to be honest. I just haven't been enjoying it at all whatsoever. It's been a hard watch, but these sort of things, once you start, I've been a loyal fan since season one. We're already, what, I think we're season six or something. It's going to be very unlikely like I'm going to, you know, suddenly drop off and not become a fan anymore. So I'm just going to have to stay with it for the time being. But again, it's not the best. I'm not too sure if I'm the only one thinking that so far, but Line of Duty, the new season so far, hasn't been that impressive. And then what else did I watch? Line of Duty. Then I rewatched on BBC iPlayer as well. Battlestar Galactica, well known amongst sci-fi fans as maybe one of the best sci-fi TV series of all time, and I agree now. I'm two seasons in. I've been told that the first two or the first three are the best, and then it kind of goes, you know, the ending's a bit crap, but, you know, c'est la vie. But so far, very, very good TV. And again, another indication, especially when you see stuff like what? Like the Star Trek they have now on Netflix and Disney, you know, the Disney version of Star Wars at the moment. There is a way to do that kind of political correctness thing where you kind of, you know, want to make sure you have a good split in terms of gender representations and, you know, ethnic and racial backgrounds and whatnot on TV. There is a great way to do it, but there's also a way to do it where you don't sacrifice the integrity or the quality of the actual product itself. And I feel like nowadays, especially with modern TV series or even movies, they are way too interested or kind of fixated on the idea of representation, and it then kind of takes away from the story itself, right? Just because you want to shoehorn a female villain into the story, you've kind of taken away the pacing, the integrity, the development, the whatever it may be of the actual story. So even if it's made up, it just takes away something from it. So when you kind of just structure a good show and just write a good show, right, regardless of who's going to play whoever, you can basically put whoever you want to play the roles, I think so. And you see that a lot with Battlestar Galactica, because without even noticing, I was like, oh, there's a lot of really strong female leads in this TV series. And this was filmed, what, Battlestar Galactica, I'm going to say, was filmed, is it early 2000s? Maybe early 2000s, maybe the end of the 90s or something. This is a long time. This is way before Gamergate and all that sort of stuff, right? And they somehow figured out and made it, you know, and made it work for them. And I think you can do the same thing nowadays, but it just takes... I think we saw a little bit with the first couple of seasons of like The Mandalorian, right? This ability to just write a great story regardless of who plays who, and then just fit in whoever you want to fit in, if you want to tick your quota boxes and stuff. But yeah, according to Wikipedia, Battlestar Galactica started in 2004. So that's what? That's a long time ago. That's more than 15 years ago, right? Battlestar Galactica was on, and it was ahead of its time in terms of the amount of people casting it that were, you know, I would say, from underrepresented, you know, regions and backgrounds or whatever they may be. Let's look at the front cover of this, and you've got at least 1, 2, 3, 4 female lead strong ones already that are integral to the whole story, the whole kind of plot of the actual thing. You've got, of course, this main lady here in the middle who's obviously integral to the whole thing as well. So there is definitely a space. There's definitely a way to do it. It's just a shame nowadays they don't do the same thing. But again, special effects wise, not the best because obviously it was filmed, you know, a long, long time ago. But the story is so much better, man. It's just like millions times better than anything you'll see nowadays. And, you know, if they do end up ever doing a reboot, you know, it's not going to be anywhere near as good as what the original was, but definitely something enjoyable to watch over the weekend. So that's been great because all the seasons, the old seasons anyway, are available to watch in full on BBC iPlayer. So that's been pretty decent. And that's been it, really. You know, spending my time doing that. Of course, gym's reopening in weekend or next week. Watching United play, which is always a bit of a, you know, a scourge of my life to watch United play at the moment. We're just in an interesting place right now, as a team, as a club, where it looks like for the most part Solskjaer is going to be that coach who's able to get us top four football consecutively, right? I think this is going to be the first time we have achieved top flight football consecutively since Alex Ferguson retired. So that's an achievement in its own, considering how far we'd kind of dropped down since that time, especially under, you know, Louis van Gaal stewardship and then most recently with Jose Mourinho. So that consistent kind of base to build from is really good. But when you just watch us game to game, it's quite obvious to see that we're just not an enjoyable team to watch. We don't play great football. I think this game against Brighton on the weekend was a very good example of it. We ended up winning 2-1. We obviously went down 1-0. A very well taken goal from Brighton. Danny Welbeck scores. Great build up play, and then it gets whipped out to the side, to the corner, yeah, to the wing. Someone crosses it in, and Danny Welbeck heads it. Dean Henderson pulls off a pretty decent save, but then he ends up kind of knocking the rebound in. And then before that, we kind of had a good 10-minute spell, I'd say. We started the game off pretty well. Brighton start, then get a little bit of control back in the game again. They start passing the ball around with far more intent, which is what we end up not doing. We end up having a lot of players being busy and knocking the ball side to side, but not really. There's no real, like, purpose behind what we do. You know, some teams, when they play football, they have these sort of patterns that they always kind of lay out on the pitch, a way to kind of progress up the field, to create a chance. We don't necessarily have that. It just feels as if, like, the players get told to play football and they just kind of create it and figure it out as they're going along. And then, of course, Brighton get the ball with a bit more purposeful. They end up getting a lead. Then they end up kind of setting a bit of control in the game. And it feels like we're going to go into one of those games, right, where we're either going to have to come back or we're going to have a bit of a draw. We're going to score maybe towards the end. We finished the first half pretty flat, not very uneventful first half, pretty hard to kind of keep my eyes open. And then we somehow come out of the second half plays again. We're not kind of on the front foot, but not really. We've got possession of the ball. We're knocking it about pretty well. Marcus Rashford ends up scoring a goal, even though he played terrible. Another, he's probably, Marcus Rashford is maybe a player that personifies United to the core, right? In game, you know, if you watch him closely, if there's just a camera on him, the amount of times he runs into players, loses possession, doesn't really affect the game with his passing, like just all the things that you probably shouldn't do as a winger, quote unquote winger forward. But then he has his moments when he suddenly turns it on and he scores a goal or creates a chance, right, out of nowhere, when he's just been playing complete dog shit. So it's really odd player to watch, but I guess he's positive outweighs negatives. And then once we kind of got that goal, it kind of went back flat again. It was back on to and fro. Not a lot of real chances created from us, I feel like, clear cut. And just a little bit of a dull game, actually. And then at the, you know, I guess I wouldn't say against the run of play, but a goal that we didn't probably construct maybe the first half deservingly. We end up doing that pretty well through Mason Greenwood, who I thought played all right. I think especially when he went center forward and kind of replaced Cavani in that role. Cavani is all happened to him. Absolutely, you know, anonymous throughout the entire game. But again, not his fault. This is another weird one to kind of, you know, remind people about Cavani. Like, you know, people like to criticize Anthony Martial and how badly he plays, but basically, if you're playing up front for Man United, you're basically playing on your own. You don't have any help. You don't have any service. You have to kind of basically get the ball yourself, you know, pass it to yourself and kind of insert yourself into the play in order for it to move around near you or for the ball to kind of reach you wherever you're standing. So we saw that happening, of course, with Mason Greenwood. He ended up getting the second goal, which I thought was a well taken, especially, you know, diving header in the box. It's the kind of goal that you want a young striker to score, because those are the quote unquote ugly centre forward goals that are going to basically be his quote unquote bread and butter. So that was great to see. And then we sort of like close out the game, but again, very uninspiring game to watch, I'm not gonna lie, especially off the back of an international break, where some of the games international break were pretty decent, even though I didn't watch a lot of them. Again, very confusing time to be a United fan, because it's quite clear Solskjaer is good enough for top four football with United. Whether or not he's good enough to be the long-term manager in terms of getting us back to winning titles and Champions Leagues and all that sort of stuff, I'm not convinced. I'm really not. I don't think better players suddenly make us play better football. I think this is what we are going to have with him. And if it means we're going to have to sign better players to get better football with the Glazers in charge, I just don't see that happening personally. But, you know, I could be wrong. I could be wrong. What else did I see? Oh, yeah, this is it. So let's get into it anyway. Enough about the football. Loads of other stuff to get on with in the show that I want to dab in. So make sure you grab yourself a little drink and a little snack, wherever that may be. And let's get in with the show. Okay, so first things first, what have I said? I'm still amazed, you know. I don't know. I won't say I'm amazed. I'm amazed. I'm still amazed at the prevalence and the kind of the prevalence and the somewhat weird desire and eagerness that some people tend to have, especially in the States. Desire they have with getting into street fights. I've never really understood it, especially nowadays in a post MMA UFC Bellator world, right, where we're seeing people, young people, old people, you know, putting themselves in harm's way and fighting in a cage with somebody that's, you know, able to kind of rain elbows and knees on their head, right? You see what professionals can do at that level. You see what people can do when they learn how to defend themselves outside of the boxing ring. And it makes me wonder, especially now with the amount of classes out there, the amount of YouTube channels doing instructional videos, why are people so willing to put themselves in harm's way and fight strangers when you have no idea what that person's about? You have no idea what they're capable of, where they're from, and what their limit is in terms of public disrespect before they end up taking your head off of your shoulders. And we obviously saw the grave, tragic result of that with that video that I posted prior, and I'll talk about on the show, I think before, of that dispute over the lawn, over the snow, is it snow? Yeah, about shoveling snow on someone's lawn, right, on their driveway or wherever, somewhere in America, where two neighbors got into this heated dispute, and it basically resulted in, you know, two of the neighbors dying and the assailant himself, you know, killing himself, just as based off just of an argument that you'd see a million times in Walmart or other places, you know, kind of video recorded. And that was kind of the extreme side of it, but also a fair warning of, like, you know, mind your business, stop, you know, getting into arguments with people. And this is another good example. This is from allegedly from Walmart, of course, which has now been epically referred to as Brawl Mart now. And it involves what I read, the recent account was, it was supposedly a former American football player, like a professional one, so he's a massive dude, versus another dude from the area, I guess, and they get into some sort of dispute which results in them in being into a fight, and the American football player, you know, basically gets told to pack his lunch. I'll play the video now.
I don't know what that nigga problem is, but he looking like he got a motherfucking problem. Come do something, motherfucker. Come do something, motherfucker.
I'm over here.
I don't give a fuck with you.
Well, who you think will win? I don't know. Black dude look a little gangster. This dude look a little swole, though.
Yeah. I don't know. Like, he's been scrapping
since. Dude looks like he's finna pull out the blick. This dude looks like he got hands. This nigga looks like he got hands, though.
Yeah.
Look.
One of the guys comes back down, he takes his little bag or whatever he's got, his tote, and puts it to the side, and then kind of says, okay, cool, enough disrespect, let's kind of scrap now. And they get into a tussle, and it ends very quickly for the other bigger dude. Absolutely washed. And you know when I knew it was over, and I knew he was going to be in trouble, was this part here. This is always a telltale sign of somebody that can't fight, a telltale sign, right? When they sort of lean over with their chin up in the air, trying to hold onto somebody, because I guess, you know, it's just an instinct thing, but you don't really know what to do with your arms. I think here, hold on, not this bit here where he gets kind of washed into the self-checkout till, but there's a bit here, just there it is, just about here, where he's kind of just reaching over. Yeah, with his left hand, his chin in the air, all exposed, you know, posture all over the place, standing completely square in front of his assailant. Look, completely has no idea what he's doing with his body. And, you know, quite easily the guy sort of basically pivots to the left hand side and just hits him with a hook as he's coming with his momentum of his entire body, and he gets completely dropped to the floor. And by that time, it's completely over, right? That's an epic pose, isn't it? Like, you can picture there somebody on the floor flat out, and then you just kind of knuckles up, ready to go again. And he's lucky the guy didn't just, you know, kick him in the head, knee him again, elbow him, ground and pound him, bash his head against the floor. Because again, this is a supermarket floor. This isn't the most bounciest of surfaces. So I'd imagine if you get knocked down and your head kind of ricochets off the floor, you're probably going to be suffering a lot of brain damage, right? Maybe not as much as the brain damage you'd probably suffer playing for American football day to day, but still enough to probably make you reconsider some of your life choices. And then, of course, you know, the most embarrassing part of all street fights, especially if you don't know how to fight, is this moment, I'm assuming, where you're not too sure where the punches came from, right? So he's turning around trying to get up, and he doesn't know where his assailant is. Like, what happened there? Was that a ninja? Was that a dream? Was there seven people? Was it one? It was one person, mate. He's standing right behind you. And he continues. He gets up, tries to defend himself and turn back around. By that time, his posture's all over the place. The guy swings again, hits him, and then he crashes into the little, you know, confectionery stand. Just as you're about to leave the supermarket, they put that little stand there just in case you want to grab yourself another snack, right? Kind of get some more money out of you. I'm not too sure if this young lady is a friend of the guy that's getting absolutely washed. He falls into the hoardings. And another good sign of when you know you're losing a fight is when a random member of the public grabs you and tries to hold onto you, right? They're trying to save you for more damage because they've seen the, you know, the fight from the beginning until basically the end. That's when you're another good sign you should know that, okay, I've lost this. I should probably just go home. When this random stranger here in a blue polo says, hey, dude, you might want to just relax here a little bit. Maybe he recognizes him. I don't know. But it looks like he's trying to save him from himself. The guy doesn't listen. He gets back up again, tries to confront the guy again, gets clipped with another right hand, falls again to his knees. He's just falling and tripping everywhere. Don't get me wrong. Maybe it's because he's just bigger and he's just, you know, ungangly. He might be like 6'5" plus in real life, which is a lot of weight to kind of support in those big legs. And he's just slipping all over the place with his little plimsolls on, not ready in any way, shape or form. Crumples underneath the pressure of his own knee, gets dragged to the ground. The guy gets on top of him. And I thought from there he was just going to rain blows on his head, but luckily he didn't. He kind of just left him on the floor there, looked at him, and kind of like, you know, a dominating position, said, hey, I won this day, right? You know what I mean? I made you my BITCH. You are my BICTH. You just stay right there. Gets on top of him, looks him in the eye, and then by that time, the fight's over. And he gets up and collects his bag and walks off. And I'm just, I don't know, man. Maybe it's just me, but I'm perplexed why these people just keep constantly getting themselves into fights when they clearly know they have no chance of winning. Now, don't get me wrong. It might just be, you know, being a red-blooded male myself, I know how it is. You get involved in a little argument with somebody, and then, you know, it escalates, and you know your pride and your ego gets in the way. But surely there must come a point where you just have to be like, you know, hey, we're gonna get involved in a screaming match, we might call each other some names, but to get involved in a full-on tussle with somebody in the supermarket, not knowing who they are, especially in the supermarket too, I'd imagine, like most places around the world, you know, many, many different people pass through the doors of a supermarket from all different walks of life, from all over the place, from all over the country, all over the state. So to get in a fight with somebody like that, you're really rolling the dice because you have no idea, right? That guy could, for all you know, that guy could be like an amateur on the flipping MMA circuit in that state, which is still good enough to wash most humans. So imagine an American football player who's probably never got into a fight in his life because of his size. That's another thing too you have to recognize. Somebody like that American football player who's, you know, he's easily, that wingspan is big. He's easily like, I don't know, 6'5" or something, 6'6" or something, whatever. He's probably been that big since he was 16. So that kind of affords you the benefit of just not being into fights because people don't want to touch you because you're just a human giant. You're just a giant, basically. So I'm sure that kind of doesn't help with your ability to defend yourself when you get into an actual scrap with an actual person that actually wants to fight you. I thought that was one of the most hilarious things I've seen this year, easy. But yeah, so big up him in it. Hopefully he's okay and he's learned his lesson and he doesn't do that thing again. But hey, you know how men are in it. You know how men are. In other news, distressing news for my lady, Anna Sorkin, free Anna. We keep screaming at her until it's backwards or until she's free. What's that thing people say? Whatever, you know what people say. And this is courtesy of Insider. The fake heiress Anna Sorkin is in ICE custody, but her post-prison business deals are still moving forward. If you're not familiar, Anna Sorkin or Anna Delvey was at the heart of a massive, finesse and scam back in the day, early 2000s, or I'm gonna say, where she kind of essentially duped her entire, you know, art ho community into believing that she was the daughter of a really wealthy billionaire, you know, richy person, whatever, came over to Europe, set up this fake art fund, interned at Purple Magazine, was gonna set up a gallery sort of workshop place, gallivanted around New York and did the whole damn thing. And then of course it got revealed that she was, you know, faking the entire thing and just kind of hustling it all on credit cards and loans and bouncing from place to place. But I think the actual thing that kind of undid her in full was the fact that she kind of scammed her friend. I forgot who her friend was. Is it Jennifer or somebody? I forgot what the name was. But the girl then went on to write a book about it. But essentially she convinced her friend to go on a trip with her to Morocco or somewhere like that, and then made her pay for the entire trip, kind of under the guise of, oh, I left my wallet, I forgot this, I forgot that. And then by the time they got back home, you know, the lady had kind of run off with all the monies. And then since then, I guess loads of other companies and places that she scammed and didn't pay the bill on kind of caught up on her. And then she had to sit down, I think, for a couple of years. I'm not too sure how long it was, but she recently got released. The rights to her life story were bought by Netflix, I'm pretty sure. One of the actresses from Ozark is going to play her, actually, so that's going to be pretty good, decent to watch. But she's been a pretty captivating and interesting person to follow from the outside in, because she reminds me so much of a lot of people that I know in my little, you know, London scene, whatever it may be, of people who try to finesse early on, right, when it was like last night's party vibe, when it was the cobra snake around, you know, those kind of party nightlife design sort of scene people, right, who essentially had to justify why they were just living outside so much and gallivanting around from art fair to art fair. And you make up these fake jobs, you intern at these bullshit magazines, you know, you have this big scheme or something you want to do and you don't really do it, you just kind of use it as a way to kind of get you into some sort of doors, and then by the time you're in, it's basically a job for life. And she basically did something that a lot of people would have done if they had the balls to do it, right? She ended up pulling it off. You know, had to sit down a bit for it, but I think in terms of the cost benefit, I think her kind of negatives far outweigh, no, the positives far outweigh the negatives, I think, in this case, because she definitely came out of this, you know, with a few more business dealings and career prospects that she probably would have if she just kind of just stuck to the common course everyone else was on. So this is courtesy of Insider. Unfortunately, things have gone awry for her again, but I'm sure she'll figure it out. It says here the following: US Immigration and Customs Enforcement have taken Anna Sorkin into custody, but her post prison business deals are still moving forward. Sorokin, the scammer and German national who pretended to be a fake heiress in the name of Anna Delvey, has been in the agency's custody since March 25th, which explains why she's gone quiet on social. I was wondering why she hasn't posted anything recently. ICE confirmed to Insider. Sorokin reported to immigration authorities herself. A law enforcement official told the Post Rebecca Rosenberg she's currently jailed in Hackensack, New Jersey, according to Post. Okay, she turned herself in. As Insider first reported, Sorokin overstayed her visa and was at risk of being deported in the conclusion of her criminal case. She was convicted in April 2019 on several counts of larceny and theft stemming from a scheme where she pretended to be a wealthy German heiress and swindled banks and other institutions out of their money while flouting around Manhattan Soho scene. She was released in February of this year and promptly made a splash sitting for interviews, feuding with photographers from the Post and Daily Mail, and teasing an apparel line with former Hood by Air designer Paul Cooper. She reached on Thursday. Cooper told Insider he wasn't sure where Sorokin was in ICE custody until the Post article was published. He said he planned to move forward with the apparel line. Good on him. We are still in goal with motion. He says she's going to be happy to see the progress done while she's unavailable. I'm definitely not about to abandon her or the project because of a minor speed bump. Well on you. Good job, Paul. It continues. Sorokin previously told Insider she planned to sell NFTs of her blog post written from prison. She also gained income from selling the rights for her life story to Netflix for a project starring Julia Garner, that's a woman from Ozark I mentioned, which is expected to be released later this year. Most of the proceeds from that sale went to paying back her victims and legal fees, as Insider reported. Court records show Sorokin also signed a $20,000 deal with a German production company called Info Network that has not been previously reported. What happens to Sorokin is unclear. It's not clear why ICE took her into custody now. She's been out of prison for 6 weeks. Court records show she had been reporting to her parole officer and she recently rented an apartment in Manhattan. Sorokin appeals to attorney Audrey Thomas is appealing her criminal case, arguing that the courts Should have considered money she took in a civil matter. Legal experts told Insider convicted criminals who are foreign nationals should not be able to remain in the US while their cases are on direct appeal. So that's a big one, because I think I did remember her kind of thumbing her nose a little bit at naysayers and critics about her being deported. She was kind of acting as if like that wasn't going to happen, this wasn't on the cards, and that's always kind of a dangerous move to do whilst you've got like an open case. I won't say open case, but you're kind of fighting your case in the appeal courts. It's probably best to kind of just keep a low profile. But you know, part of the reason why people are intrigued by her is because she does everything but keep a low profile. So I guess she was stuck in that weird position, and if you keep a low profile, you don't get a chance to kind of capitalize on your little 5 minutes of fame and try to stretch it out as long as you can. And and of course, if you do kind of address it and kind of go ahead first, you also then get the maybe the possibility they might draw more attention to yourself that might alert the ICE authorities of your presence. But some would argue that I'm pretty sure ICE probably had her on their watch list anyway, regardless, isn't it? Because she's a foreign national in the first place. It continues. Sorokin was scheduled to put on a plane on March 26th, according to New York Post, but ultimately wasn't. Court records show Sorokin was still in the US on March 29th, and ICE denied Thomas's request to block her removal that same day. So they blocked her removal, but she wasn't flown out on that date. So I'm assuming they're probably going to try and work out a new date or something, which is going to be concerning for her. A representative for ICE told Insider the agency will not be releasing any information on the individual at this time. He interviewed Insider shortly after release from prison. Sorokin said she planned to write a book about how pointless the US criminal justice system is. Again, another point he probably shouldn't be discussing openly like that. She says, "I feel it's like it's insane." She told Insider to take people to lock them up, take everything away from them, and just expect them to reform. What is that supposed to do for you? So again, it's going to be a setback, I guess, for her in terms personally, but I think in general, considering, you know, we're living in 2021 with the internet, she'll be pretty much okay, I think. As long as she's able to kind of do her stuff via laptops and whatever it may be, she'll be pretty all right, and she'll probably be able to figure it out. But that's the latest development in the Anna Sorokin, aka Anna Delvey, episode. And again, this is probably just going to add more chapters to the book itself when that eventually comes out, or the biopic. Next on the list here, what else do we have? We have news courtesy of, what's this, NBC Los Angeles. California to allow indoor gatherings as virus cases plummet. This is courtesy of NBC Los Angeles. As the following, California will allow indoor concerts, theater performances, and other private gatherings starting April 15th as the rate of people testing positive for coronavirus in the states nears a record low. The decision is a sharp turnaround in the slow pace as California has taken on lifting the restrictions, and comes as the governor urges people to continue to being vigilant about wearing masks and maintaining social distancing. To attend gatherings, people will have to either be tested or show proof of full vaccinations. California has administered nearly 19 million doses, and nearly 6.9 million people are fully vaccinated in the state, with nearly 40 million residents, but only people 50 and over are eligible to statewide to get a vaccine now. Adults 16 and older won't be eligible until April 15th. From what I've heard so far through the LA podcast in Grapevine, there's a lot of people getting them, you know, that probably shouldn't be getting them because there's surplus in supply. So I'm sure if you're able to get one, or you want to, you're probably going to find a way to get it. But this is also interesting, considering this is definitely, I feel like, a response somewhat, it feels like, from Gavin Newsom to the recall effort that's taking place. And it's funny what people will do and how fast they will act when they feel like their job is under threat, which again is shows you how much of a sham politics is in general, unless it's something that serves their own personal purpose, or you know, beliefs or interests. They won't really follow through or push anything through. And the fact that, you know, Gavin Newsom's job is being come, you know, is coming under threat, of course mostly due to his response to the COVID outbreak, obviously, in California, how he's locked down certain parts of the industry or certain parts of business and economy, but opened up other places and not really responded well in the same thing. And the thousands and thousands of people in the entertainment industry that have effectively fled LA for other states because they feel like the restrictions are not allowing him to make a living, the closure of schools. And then suddenly, when it feels like his job is going to come under threat, he kind of pulls off all the stops and implements, you know, or kind of allows certain segments of the industry or the economy, sorry, to reopen, and obviously kind of opens up all the vaccinations and stuff going forward. It's just as a, it's terrible, really, and it really is self-interest. As much as politicians have to kind of talk to and address the constituents' self-interest when people want to go out there and vote, it's also kind of something that they also require as well, right? They also want, they also will only act on things that definitely greatly kind of respond to them. And this is an article here from Politico talking a little bit about that. It says Arnold Schwarzenegger has a warning for Gavin Newsom. And Arnold Schwarzenegger, if you famously remember, took advantage of the recall too to become governor of California back in the day. And it says here, they asked him the question, do the 2003 California recall that brought you to power and the current recall against Gavin Newsom have anything in common? He says the following: it's pretty much the same atmosphere today as it was then. There was a dissatisfaction to the highest level in the political leadership. He says people are working very hard, people are making unbelievable sacrifices every day. It's very tough to raise kids and to have a family and to go through this challenge working to make ends meet, and you feel like, wait a minute, but Sacramento doesn't really do everything for us and that promise they'll do. We are working hard, but they are not. They are failing us every day. That's why I see the similarities of 2003 is it's the same vibe, and it's the same with the momentum, something that sets it off to a higher level, kind of the straw that breaks the camel's back, like an explosion. In Newsom's case, it was a French Laundry thing. With us, it was a power outage of 2003. And that French Laundry thing is going to be something that he's going to rue until the end of his day, isn't it? The fact that he was, you know, photographed, you know, sitting in a pretty, you know, from what I've heard, shitty expensive restaurant, off the back of telling others that they couldn't go and eat indoors and eat in restaurants, and, you know, maskless with strangers in there, was really, really, you know, a bad on goal if ever there was one. It continues here. They ask him, Newsom's team says it's a Republican recall and an effort to overthrow a Democratic governor. Is that how you see it? Arnold Schwarzenegger says the following: that Republican Party is, like I have said, a dying at the box office. This is the crazy thing here. When they say it's a quote-unquote power grab of the Republicans, let me tell you, the California Republicans couldn't even get anyone elected. It's ludicrous. The Republican Party doesn't exist. These are the signatures of ordinary folks that have signed on. And that's another one as well that you see a lot of politicians do, right? Especially in the States more so. Whenever there are people kind of calling them out for their hypocrisy or pointing out things that they clearly haven't done or followed through on their promises, there's always the kind of easy out to kind of, you know, call them or brand them to be alt-right, brand them to be Republican, brand it as like a, you know, a smear campaign or whatever it may be, instead of actually addressing the concerns of regular everyday folk. Because for as much as those Joe Rogan figures exist who are kind of complaining that they aren't able to kind of go and perform on stage and shit, right? Multi-millionaires complaining about multi-million things. I'm pretty sure there are a lot of kind of regular people that live in California that are also fed up that they can't just take their kids to school. They can't, you know, go and work in an office or just live their lives day to day. And to kind of dismiss those concerns as just Republican power grab is definitely going to hinder, you know, the possibility of him kind of dismissing this recall, which I'm sure it's not going to be dismissing him. I think it's too late now. From last time I checked, they had close to 2 million signatures already, so that's pretty much done, sealed and delivered, isn't it? So another catastrophe, another victim of COVID is probably going to be Gavin Newsom's political career, isn't it? But that's it. What can you do? Moving on and talking about all things LA, we have this interesting update here from the Austonia. Most things LA adjacent. Let's call it LA adjacent. This is courtesy of the Austonia. A few people have sent this to me, so big up everyone that sent this article to me. That was much, much appreciated. It says the following: exclusive, Joe Rogan buying the West Theater. So Joe Rogan buying West Austin Theatre for a new comedy club wants to make Austin a new hub for big laughs. So this is a really big deal. If you remember previously, of course, Joe Rogan moved to Austin recently, obviously, as a reaction to all the numerous restrictions being put on the hospitality and entertainment industry in the state of California that he was at previously. And the kind of plan was to kind of turn Austin into a beacon, a new hub of comedy and live entertainment and all that good stuff. And maybe this was kind of a natural progression of Joe, especially since he's been touring and going around with Dave Chappelle and doing shows all over America, you know, social distancing ones with Tess, whatever they maybe be. And they're pretty decent productions from what I've seen from afar. So maybe that kind of gave him the bug to maybe set up his own thing. It might be a response to the Comedy Store documentary where he speaks in glowing terms about how important and integral part Mitchie Shore played in his career and the career of everybody else that performed at the Comedy Store, and the fact that it's never going to be like that again, you know, due to, you know, whatever scandals are before laid some people that are there, the fact that California's on the lockdown, whatever it may be. There's definitely been a switch in Joe Rogan's kind of outlook and approach to how he deals with comedy, and maybe the fact that he's seen now, you know, the level that he's at, the only way he's able to really give back to comedians, especially if they're unable to get his podcast, which is probably backed up with guests until maybe 2 years out, is to maybe have a comedy club where he could just open it up to everybody. They're probably going to have open mic nights during the week. They're probably going to have what's that thing called, showcases and all that good stuff, a whole list of regulars. So it's a great way to kind of give back to something that obviously he feels has contributed a lot to his overall success, and of course maybe give some credence to this idea that there's going to be a new entertainment hub kind of brewing from in Austin, Texas. Now, it's probably unlikely because, you know, LA has been the heartbeat of entertainment in North America for a long time, hundreds of years, let's say. So it's very unlikely that one pandemic is going to suddenly shift the focus to other places, but it might disperse and kind of you know, spread out some of the talent in other places, which might be a healthy thing overall for the scene. But let's continue. This, I think, is a club that he purchased itself. It said, since making his well-documented move from to Austin from Los Angeles, multi-million-dollar podcaster Joe Rogan has been singing the praises of his new home and making himself right at home. So what's next for Rogan and Austin? Austin Tony has confirmed with multiple sources that Rogan is taking the decades of experience of stand-up comedy, first starting in the career in 1988, and finally, drumroll, opening up a very young club in Capital City. Though the rumors have also been suggested that he's purchased a now-closed Alma Ritz and a soon-to-be-open Cap City Comedy, multiple sources who asked to remain anonymous told Estonia that the new home of Rogan's latest endeavor is the One World Theatre located on 7701 BK Road. The theatre is a convenient 10-minute drive from Rogan's $4.4 million Westlake mansion. I'm pretty sure he's going to be happy that they mentioned that in the article. It continues, and Rogan will run the theatre with fellow comedian, which is a big development here, Adam Eager, who's been on the Joe Rogan podcast experience, made a journey from LA to Austin for the gig. The One World Theatre did not respond for numerous calls and messages from Estonia. So that's interesting. Adam Eager, if you're familiar, was also the co-host to the Norman guy podcast, and obviously famously, if you remember from the Comedy Store, he's now the talent booker there as well. Somebody who a lot of people in that store kind of rate, especially some of the old timers and some of the newer guys. He gives people a chance. He's really fairly fair in terms of how he puts stuff together. So this was something I was curious about when he did mention it a few times, whether or not he was going to be, you know, hands-on Rogan in terms of building a comedy club from the ground up, whether or not he'd get someone in to just handle the kind of administrative sort of side of running the whole shebang. Because it's one thing having a club associated with you or known that you kind of founded it and kind of running it day to day, I'm assuming, can be a bit of a ball ache. I'm pretty sure that Ego probably has some stories, horror ones, about running a comedy club day to day and having to deal with, you know, comedians and their egos and their insecurities and stuff. It's probably something that only a certain group of people can do. So that definitely makes it known that Rogan's definitely taking it seriously, right? I mean, he's getting people in who know exactly what they're doing. He's flew over, you know, Adam Eager from LA, brought him over to Austin and said, hey, open this club with me, set up the way you want it, and let's kind of recreate that magic in this new place with maybe a fresh approach. So this definitely tells me that they're not ramping around. This isn't some pop-up thing. This is for real, which is great to see. It continues, the One World Theatre opened its doors in 1999 when the current owners, Hat and Nadastians, decided to bring concerts, dance, theatrical, and kids productions to the new venue in association with their equal partner, the Barton Creek Arts Center. The Stearns acquired 100% interest in the property in 2007 and have been running it since. According to the Travis Central Appraisal District, the property is on the second foreclosure and likely sustained damages due to the winter storm. We know it's been a long time coming for Rogan to finally buy his first club, and here's what we observed over the years. For months now, so yeah, Rogan's been planning to start a club for months now. The latest, you got here a sign shortly after the Rogan announced his California exit, Rogan sat down for an August 2020 podcast with comedian Joe Diaz to talk about the fracking and the effects that it's had on the environment along with the coast and how it was one of the reasons he wanted to leave. In response to his move, Diaz asked Rogan if he plans to do a comedy club once he breaks ground. He said, most likely I'm going to do a comedy club in Austin. It'll be for fun for all of us. And of course, he's been keeping company with fellow funny. He's got a picture here of Rogan and a few other comedians. Blah, 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 blah. The iconoclast has performed at dozens of shows around Austin since he's made his move. Rogan's frequents venues like Stubbs, BBQ, ACL Live, and Moody Theatre. Rogan recently appeared in a series of comedy shows alongside fellow comedian Dave Chappelle, and also been seen performing with Ron White, Donald Rawlings, and Michelle Wolf. Rogan also is coaxing friends like Diaz to follow his path down to Austin. That's not happening. I think he's still in New Jersey. He said he's a longtime staple of the comedy LA store here, the comedy store in LA. So yeah, let's see what happens, man. He's not looking to make money. Oh, I also see the bottom bit here. He's not looking to make money. With the podcast worth upwards of $100 million, Rogan's pockets are lined. Oops, get that off the screen. Aligned. Yeah, another podcast in the September, this time with Wyatt. Rogan said that he was on the lookout for a ranch and a comedy club in Austin. Rogan said that he wants to help local comics get up and write and get up. Local comics get on the up and up, and when he starts a club. And also said the idea is to open a club. When we open the club, I should say, is to have these local guys come in, pump them up, and people know that there is a real scene here, and help them, not just Austin comics but from everywhere, bring them into the space and have this club be a hub. That's really cool. So again, because I think in other ways this probably wouldn't work if it's like a rich dude who happens to be a comedian opening up a club. It's just gonna be him kind of performing amongst his friends and getting his friends on stage. But I think the way Rogan speaks so glowingly about his time at the comedy store, the role, again, I said, the bits he played in his career, how making him a regular and what that did to kind of, you know, for his legitimacy and kind of making him, you know, one of the guys and all that malarkey. I think he's going to be very aware of the power of that kind of providing that platform for people on the up and cut up, as I mentioned in the article. So I'm pretty sure this will definitely be a thing that he does for, you know, for kind of giving back sakes, as opposed to just making money. Because I'm sure, you know, most clubs probably don't make that much money anyway in the first place outside of their big nights. So it's definitely not something you get into as a get rich quick scheme. So let's see, it continues here. That's the end of the article. But yeah, good news, isn't it, for everybody located in Austin, or I guess comedy fans overall, especially when life returns back to normal. It might inadvertently improve podcasting material and content too for us fans, because it's been a bit grim and a bit hard of a slog to listen to some of our favorite comedians on podcasts, because I guess they've not been able to scratch that itch of performing. So a lot of the people that we kind of generally do enjoy have been quite insufferable during this time, I've kind of noticed. So this might be a good thing in general, that clubs are, you know, he's approaching a club, venues are opening up in LA, you know, you can, some people are doing tours, blah 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 blah, things are starting to get back to normal, so they can go back to doing what they are meant to be doing day to day, instead of, you know, talking into microphones as I am on the podcast and whatnot, can sometimes be great, but maybe not the thing that they really want to do. So yeah, let's see. Good news overall. Let's move on. 1 second. Let's see here what the time is saying. Good. Cool. What else we have here? Oh yeah. This is fucking epic, isn't it? Have you guys been, obviously, most of you are aware that, you know, I'm a big advocate. I'm a big fan of Playboi Carti's. Of course, I wasn't the biggest fan of Whole Lotta Red. I think I mentioned it on this podcast already. I've made a little review. I thought the Whole Lotta Red was incredibly lackluster, considering the wait time, especially for big Carti fans, considering how great Die Lit was, and considering how monumental, you know, the self-titled first album was. I thought Whole Lotta Red kind of flattered to deceive somewhat. But, you know, I'm glad to see he's sort of like experimenting a little bit more with his voice, artistically, and maybe, I guess, creative direction wise he's sort of very much pivoted into this whole like gay vampire vibe thing that he's doing at the moment, which is again great to see. He's kind of living his truth and doing his thing. But it's also funny to see the amount of clones and disciples and copycats that's just sort of inadvertently birthed. Now, I'm not too sure if this is people just directly copying and referencing Playboi Carti's aesthetic, or whether it's more to do with the fact that it seems to be a weird cultural coincidence just when Rick Owens ended up, you know, being the new Playboi comedy gossip for some reason, right? You're seeing loads of random people wearing Rick Owens dunks and geo baskets and dresses and bags and sunglasses and stuff. It just, you know, it's become like the it brand at the moment, especially within the quote-unquote urban community. So I'm not sure whether or not it's just a coincidence that it's when that has kind of been, you know, popped into the mainstream, and also Carti's whole lot of Red came out at the same sort of time, and that whole vampire aesthetic with the Alix and the you know, the new Giovanni and the Rickons, all that stuff, Malaki, and it sort of converged into this weird place that we're in now, where it's kind of resulted in this really amazing video that went viral over the weekend of this kid that was posted supposedly by his baby mother, right? And it says, yeah, this is the tweet itself. So I really expected this 30-year-old to be a good father. Jokes. And I'll play the video for you now. And if you're watching via the if you're listening via the podcast app, I just implore you to definitely check out the video portion of the show, because this is hilarious. So it's this kid, and he's like, you know, got stacked, I guess, flared jeans on, with some new rock type boots on, a metal tee that's sort of like been cut in half and then sewn back together, two parts of a different tee. He's got dreads and one glove on, and he's sort of like doing all these like really effeminate sort of like, you know, mannerism things, similar to what you'll see Uzi or maybe Playboi Carti doing when they're posing. And of course Playboi Carti is playing in the background. It's really, really cringe. And for some reason he's got V-Lone tatted underneath his right eye, which I thought was always weird, innit? Like, I think I know Carti's got one tied next to his neck, but again, he's friends with Young Lord, who actually puts his brand together. I think if you're related or you're in that inner circle, it's one thing, but for just a regular fan that's just buying it off the interwebs to just suddenly get, you know, V-Lone tatted on the side of your face is very, very bizarre. But hey, so embarrassing, isn't it? It's I guess it's some sort of photo shoot, right? Because you can hear people in the background talking and stuff, but wouldn't you be embarrassed doing this sort of stuff in front of people randomly, like in a studio somewhere, pretending to be somebody who you're? I guess the guy's what, 30, and how old is Carti? 27 or something? There's something really embarrassing about that. Highly, highly embarrassing. I would say who's raised. I would say. I would say he's raising these kids, but he's not. And he's a grown man. So I don't know what it is, man. Like, maybe it's just me, but when I was growing up, there was a distinct need or desire intrinsically, right? A burning fire in you to be as different as you could from your peers. Right, the moment somebody next to you started to copy or wear the thing that you were wearing, you just jumped off it and wore something else. I remember previously when we were coming up, the kind of quote-unquote style sort of icons in the scene at the time at streetwear were maybe like someone like Pharrell, right? Pharrell and Nigga, obviously, when they were kind of hanging out doing Bape and BBC, those are kind of the people everyone's sort of like looking at, and maybe some random skaters from Supreme here and there, right? But the moment something sort of like popped into the mainstream and suddenly got worn by, let's say, a Big Sean or whatever, you just jumped off it straight away. You didn't want to be ever you didn't want anyone to ever come up to you and say, oh wow, you're wearing that Pharrell hat, or you're wearing that Nigga chain. You wanted to always kind of maybe take some cues from what they're doing, but then kind of mix it in with the stuff that you want to actually wear, your own sort of quote-unquote personal style. But to kind of take your entire personal style and wardrobe from another dude, especially a very famous rapper, especially a very famous rapper with a very specific and niche look, is so many levels of pathetic. It just doesn't even bother even talking about. It's just insane. And he's not the only guy, right? It's not just him. There's this mad slideshow someone put together, images, right, of these four kids that I guess, including himself, in this weird pose, these kind of weird effeminate crazy poses that they're all doing. And it's just utterly bizarre. But it also may be a good indication for Carti that he's legitimately influencing and penetrating culture, when you're able to get these kids who probably a year or two ago, maybe even 16 months ago, would have had no idea what Rick Owens was, you know, what some of these other goth brands are, right? And now suddenly they're all decked out in it, they're wearing a super skinny jeans with massive boots on, doing these odd poses and whatever, you know, eyeliner and nail varnish and one glove and whatever it may be. But god almighty, it's just, the levels of cringe is insane. But you know, I guess in an effort to be different, because I'm sure they all don't think they look like each other, but they all look so similar. I guess these two are the same people because of the backgrounds, but it's just, I don't know, man. I couldn't live with myself going outdoors knowing that I've kind of dressed myself head to toe the same as some other dude, especially, like I said, a very, very famous and influential rapper. Like, it's bad enough for me nowadays, especially because it seems like people like someone like an A$AP Rocky or an A$AP Nas, they seem to be people who are genuinely interested in fashion, so they tend to sometimes have the, I won't say similar taste, but like they seem to sometimes buy the things I would kind of like to buy. And just the moment they do purchase something like that and they wear it and they kind of photographed in it, it essentially, what it does, it takes it off my rotation. I can't then wear that thing again, or I'm going to be at the risk of being accused of wearing that A$AP Nas, A$AP Rocky outfit. And these guys seem to kind of lean into it. Maybe it's a new thing with the younger generation, they don't mind looking like other people, right? But I don't know, there was a time when I was coming up where this was just not it. You could never ever be caught dead rocking anything that someone else was rocking, especially to this level of pride and awareness. And of course, someone posted this great screenshot of lyrics from self-titled and Whole Lotta Red, you know, woke up like with niggas talking like me, woke up like niggas sounding like me, and then of course the next slide, all these niggas dressing like me. And then we thought it was a joke, right? He kept kind of repeating this same sort of adage in most of his tracks, but it's definitely just something rings true. But I don't know, I don't get it, man. Look at these things, like, what are these kids doing? There's a bit of Bloody Osiris mixed into this as well, right? Because he's really good at doing these sort of like convoluted street style things, right? He's probably one of the best performance artists in our time in that regards. But god damn it, this is embarrassing, man. Like, what is this? Like, legitimately, what is this? Like, I don't know. I really don't know. You know, it's bad enough when you got the kind of the regen, the UK regen of Playboi Carti and Lancey Foe doing the similar sort of thing. But he can maybe be excused because he can maybe say, hey, I was doing it at the same time in my own way, blah 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 blah. But this is just straight up copying, and it's just so cringe, really, really cringe. And I would love to hear, actually, this kid here. I'm pretty sure this kid, whoever he is, his name's Hell, I don't know what his name is, right? I'm pretty sure if he makes music, how much you want to bet that his music sounds exactly like Carti as well? That's the thing that makes it worse. Like, fair enough taking one man's aesthetic to kind of find your way in terms stylistically, which I still think is, you know, cringe and GAY, but regardless. But then to just take his entire style and also then take his artistic expression, wherever it is in your field, it's just, that's just, you know, how can you live with yourself? I really don't know. But again, maybe I'm just old and cranky and have no idea what's going on in the scene out there. But I thought that was highly, highly embarrassing. I recommend you do check it out. If you're listening to the audio podcast, please do check it out. It's a tweet by a person called, what does it say here? SA_TEEVA. SA_TEEVA. Check out her profile, she's definitely got that. I'm pretty sure it's probably one of her pinned tweets on her account, because it's gotten a lot of reaction online. But it's amazing, man, absolutely amazing. Anyway, let's continue. Next on the list, oh, there's a pretty great interview at the moment out with Cohen Frost on his channel with Jerry Lorenzo, of course, from Fear of God. And he talks really well about his, obviously, intern journey over. I'm about halfway through it now at the moment. But there's this really great clip that's been taken out of it that basically people are spreading across social, where he essentially talks about, you know, being a creative director of a fashion house, and that's not something that he kind of wanted to do. And he always wanted to kind of get into the game to build his own thing and kind of build that into being the next Ralph. And it's really, really inspiring and really great to see somebody at the level that he's at also reminding other kids that are coming up in streetwear designing and stuff that it's not always about just being accepted by the fashion people, because there's this weird thing around it in streetwear at the moment. I'm not too sure what happened and when that changed, but it's definitely something I've noticed. But definitely grateful that Jerry Lorenzo kind of spoke upon it and hopefully lend some sort of credence to the idea that, you know, making your brand and making it into being whatever you want it to be, and in this current era we're living in now at the moment, should be enough. You shouldn't just be looking for validation from fashion people, especially considering how nutty that whole industry is in general. So this is the clip.
Being home during the pandemic just really gave me a greater desire to just be here in Los Angeles, yeah. And you know, take my girls to horseback riding or take my son to baseball. And I want to build something. Yeah. You know, my desire has always been to build Fear of God. I wasn't a fashion kid, so I never had an aspiration to like be a part of something or an industry where I never felt wanted anyhow.
Yeah.
And so it's just not in me to desire to want to be it. Creative director, Not to say that people are calling me to be a creative director. That's not the case. Oh. But it's just not in me. My desire is to build Fear of God to, like, you know, Ralph Lauren Heights.
Yeah.
That's what I want to do. Yeah. I want to be a business owner and, you know, creative direct my own journey. And why do we as people of color or from streetwear need to feel like we need to be validated by doing someone something else's like house. That? And so I'm not chasing that validation. And not to say that anyone that has done that is chasing anything.
Right.
And I think that, you know, what Virgil is doing and what Matt is doing at the level that they're doing it, you know, Virgil is carrying his cross that allows me to carry my own cross here. And it's in some so indirect forth. Way, he's validating what I'm doing by 100%. Him doing that. And so he does that, so I don't have to do that.
Yeah.
You know, I'm saying, hold with that, so you don't got to do that.
Yeah.
So it's like I know what my calling is. I know what I want to say.
Yeah.
And I think I learned a lot from that Zania opportunity in terms of, like, the pushback, what you may get from a house.
Right, right.
And I want to say what I want to say.
Yeah.
And I don't have the bandwidth to, like, fight with you on, like, my perspective.
Yeah.
I need the freedom to express myself how I want to, when I want to. We don't put collections out on the fashion calendar. We put them out when they're ready.
Yeah.
And so I need the freedom to be able to do that, you know, and that's a part of who we are. And to get on that, like, track and that treadmill is something that is just not attractive at all.
Yeah. No.
And if you remember correctly, if you've been keeping an eye on what Jay Lorenzo has been doing in his career, you would be familiar that he's been saying this for a while. Because I remember one time, I forgot what interview it was, but there was one particular one where he mentioned how he felt a little bit put out when he went to Paris and he kind of carried a suitcase full of some early samples of Fear of God, and he felt like people were kind of sunning him a little bit. It might have been during the time when he went to Paris and he attended that Vetements show, right? The first Vetements show, because I'm pretty sure he's in the crowd, he's in the front row. Because I remember they're playing like a Boys Noise track that we never actually got a track ID for in the end because he never released it. But he's in the front row sort of aggressively nodding his head. I think that was the same sort of time. And he said, oh, he kind of felt a little bit sunned. Like they kind of tried to big timing out there in Paris. Even though he was making the stuff himself by hand and sort of looking for help and maybe retailers or whatever. Maybe, I don't know what it was. But he kind of always, from that conversation, it did kind of seem like he saw what it's like to actually be a part of the system and be in there, be around amongst fashion people, and he suddenly realized out there, you know what, this isn't for me. He obviously still goes out there to, you know, support friends or whatnot, I'm guessing, and do whatever he needs to do for his brand, but in terms of being part of the machine, he's always kind of been away from that. And I would assume as well, with the Zegna collaboration that was, you know, beautiful from what we saw, you can just imagine what the conversations were like behind the scenes, right, putting that collection together, the sensibilities and the taste levels and the work, you know, practices and the approach and the tone of voice that some Americans and people from Europe have, especially, you know, very rich and aristocratic sort of posh Italians from a very storied house like Zegna. You can imagine the kind of cultural differences that sort of arose from that collaboration. And in the end, we got, you know, great products from it. You know, we got that amazing snapback that probably will go down in history as one of the best snapbacks of all time. But overall, I can imagine what would have happened behind the scenes. Probably would have been another reminder for him, hey, just do your own thing and kind of run your own course. And I think it's healthy as well in it seen to have each person doing things their own way, each person doing things really well in their own little different way. You know, the way Matthew Williams is running Givenchy or being able to run Givenchy isn't the same way that Louis Vuitton or Virgil gets to do at Louis, isn't the same way that Virgil does his Off-White thing, isn't the same way that, you know, Jerry's doing his Fear of God and Essentials. They're all doing things in their different sort of ways, and I like that approach about things, and it gives kids coming up different examples that they can follow, so they don't all have to kind of follow the same route. And I would assume, again, I get the allure with Paris and fashion in general, because like I've mentioned in other shows, I was a little bit of a naysayer too to the industry by and large, because I would count myself more as a kid, a product of streetwear, right? That's where I got my entire education from. I owe a lot to that entire scene, you know, worldwide, for kind of educating me on many, many different things, from art to fashion to design and whatever it may be. But I did realize when I went to my first show, that was one of the Virgil shows, I forgot which one it was, or the one where Ian Connor runs out at the end of the runway, I was there for that show, and I did get to experience what it's like to be somebody that's quote unquote invited and sort of like, you know, taken around to certain places, you know, invited to certain after parties and gallery openings, whatever not, but during that whole time, like an influencer would be, and it's a pretty dope experience. So I can only imagine what it's like to be an actual brand owner, right? Somebody that's actually making the things and not just consuming it. It must be wonderful, right, to be with these people, having dinner, sharing stories and talking about your design ethos and your whatever it may be, and getting this weird kind of different level of validation from these European people, right, who seem to have a lot more culture and sophistication than you, especially if you think you're this oaf from North America. I can imagine why it can be somewhat alluring, but again, like I said, I think it is deceiving because they're a little bit transactional and a little bit kind of seasony, and you know, in the moment with you anyway, you're the hot thing now and then you're not the hot thing later. You know, they were in love with skaters for a couple of seasons and they fell out of love again, then recently they love streetwear, and then suddenly they're writing op-eds about the death of streetwear, the return of tailoring, which I took to be a bit of a dog whistle to getting all the blacks and, you know, brown people out of fashion and whatever it may be. So I guess in general they don't really want us to be there, so I don't really see why we kind of have to always kind of curtail and bend and sort of appease what they're kind of into. But again, I understand the money, the access, the resource, all that sort of stuff is on that side of things, but there is still a lot on the outside of things when it comes straight with dealing with it. But you just need to be able, you just need to kind of, I wouldn't say be able, you kind of have to know, I'd imagine, what you kind of got in it for, right? If you're happy with kind of supplying and providing for your little community of people, you know, being able to do some really cool collaborations, you know, be a valuable member of your peer group, have a great store, whatever it may be, then there's definitely avenues for it. But the moment you want to try and expand and kind of push into bigger markets and whatnot, you're inevitably going to have to touch those kind of people. But like I said, I think it's really refreshing that, you know, Jerry was able to kind of speak about the desire and the need to kind of just stay doing what he's doing to a high level, and that's enough for him, and hopefully other kids will see that and maybe take that as an example going forward. Hopefully Let's continue to see how much time I've got here going forward. What else have I used? Okay, there we go. Bish, bash, bosh. What else we got here? Oh, yeah, this is quite good as well. We got here courtesy of Ask Pizza. This is pretty cool, isn't it? So Ask Pizza, a very well-known artist, obviously, mainly from streetwear, I would say. Mostly, I'd say kind of, what do you say? He's come from that group of Luca and all those kind of dudes and other guys as well who used to do a bit of artwork, wherever it may be. He basically let it be known on social recently that he's got an official collaboration with Supreme coming out. I'm assuming this season or next, I'm not too sure. I'm assuming next season, this is the caption, it says the following. Thank you, Supreme New York. If anyone knows me, you'll know how special this is. I made the triple box logo hoodie fucking around and has now become something insane. First thing I told Supreme is we have to do something real that gets everyone involved, tap back into the streets and make this into an exciting again. 2021 is about to be the craziest year of my life. Thank you for everyone who supported me, and thank you for Supreme for actually giving me this chance. And as you can see on the t-shirt itself, it's the famous triple box logo design that Ask Pizza was famous for doing on the hoodie. I think he cut up different box logos and put them all on one hoodie, which was epic back in the day. I think it was, might have been on Vine if I remember correctly. And on the back he's got his signature, he's basically signature down the back, 2021 written with obviously that mark. And then we've got some stickers here, and then I think if you look here, I think there's actually an advertisement or maybe something, a poster showing some more stuff that we're going to be seeing going forward. There's advertisements for him and his friends, you know, posted up wearing some of the t-shirts. You've got Shekwes here and a few other people dotted around, so this is going to be pretty cool going forward, man. I'm really happy for him. This is really awesome to see, and it's cool too because I remember reaching out to Ask Pizza. This might have been 2014, 2013, I'm going to say around then, when I was working for a very well-known art supplies manufacturer, and ended up sending him over a few, you know, markers and pens, whatever. So I'm hoping some of that stuff is still in his collection now at the moment that he's still using. That'd be pretty cool to see. But again, this is a very legit and awesome collaboration from Supreme. Again, another reminder, right? No matter how corny they get, mostly due to their fans, it's not really based on them. No matter how corny they get and how overplayed some people might think the brand is, the great thing they do always, I think personally, is that they provide, you know, very, what would you say, cult hero face. They provide kind of like artists, right, doing their thing, with an opportunity to put some money in their pocket. Obviously, I'm not too sure how the deal gets structured with these sort of artist collaborations, whether or not you get a flat fee or you get a percentage of the sales. But regardless, they put some money in their pocket, and they also provide them with a platform to kind of bolster their message and their works and who they are to a wider audience. Because for sure, off the back of this, it's going to be the shirt element. There's also going to be the lookbook. There's also going to be the posters, on the street, whatever activation he has planned that he's mentioned in the post. And I'm assuming some sort of video thing that they're going to do going forward. So loads of points of reference that you can basically use to kind of leverage the Supreme name and the audience to then use as a platform to build onto other things. And that's something that you can't really be said for a lot of other brands, isn't it? They really do dig deep into the archives, whether the people are alive or dead. They definitely go out and reach out to the artists for sure, kind of get the rights to the, you know, sign off permission, whatever it may be, and do it the right way. And I'm really, you know, that's something to kind of definitely be lauded upon. They don't have to do it that way, but they kind of go about it the right way in general, all these collaborations. And for the most part, I can't think of many artists really who have kind of said a bad word about their experience and working with them in terms of what they've done. Some of course haven't seen a light of day due to copyright issues and stuff behind the scenes, but the ones that I have been able to see have been really, really good and well worked out. Even if it's just like them having people model, right? I think of somebody like a Cyprian Galliard from back in the day, one of the OG models for Supreme from ages ago. You know, he was featured in the thing, and I'm pretty sure that helped his profile as an artist. And you know, I even know his name to this day because of what Supreme were able to do and put him on the map and all that sort of good stuff. So I'm sure those guys definitely feel have a lot of kind of good things to say about what they do and how they put on for artists going forward. But yeah, man, this is pretty dope to see. Again, I would definitely say, again, I mentioned to somebody else, Art Piece is definitely maybe one of the greatest, if not the best artist of his generation. So for somebody in a position to get this collab at this point of his career is definitely something to be heralded and to shout home about, man. Great to see. Great to see. And I think that's it, man. I think that's it for the Agostinho Zinga Show, episode number 445. Thanks so much for tuning in whatsoever. It's been a pleasure to have your company as per usual. If it's your first time tuning into the show via YouTube and all that good stuff, make sure you smash that like button, subscribe, leave a comment down below. And if you listen to the podcast app, of course, a 5-star review will help spread the show. And again, support via Patreon is also more than welcome. You can find the link in the descriptions. Get involved today. Don't delay. See you guys again very, very soon.